Creationism versus evolution. Fundamentalists versus modernists. Tradition versus change. These were some of the issues addressed in the 1925 John Scopes monkey trial. Intrigued? Well, you should be. This was a big case and quite a circus, literally.
Who was the monkey, Professor? And what did he do?
Oh, there was no monkey on trial here, Stryker, but still a lot of monkey business going on.
I'm confused. Why did they call it the monkey trial then?
Well, have you ever heard of Darwin's theory of evolution?
I believe so. Isn't that the theory introduced to the world in 1859, opposing the Bible teaching that man was created in God's image, which states that we are all descendants of monkeys and a big bang that happened billions of years ago?
Not bad. Well, in February 1925, the Tennessee legislature enacted a bill introduced by John Butler which prohibited public schools from teaching the theory of evolution.
Okay.
But the ACLU...
The ACL who?
The American Civil Liberties Union opposed the law and offered to fund the legal defense for any teacher in the state of Tennessee who was willing to fight the law in court. John Scopes volunteered. Scopes was a 24-year-old substitute science teacher and football coach who admitted to teaching the theory of evolution from the state-approved textbook. He was arrested and put on trial.
That doesn't seem very fair. Someone told him to do it.
Yes, but don't worry. That was the ACLU's plan. They wanted this to go to trial.
Well, I hope the ACLU hired a good defense team for him.
Oh, one of the best, led by the famous attorney Clarence Darrow.
Who was the prosecutor?
William Jennings Bryan, a 3-time presidential candidate and former Secretary of State, led the way. Called the Great Commoner, Bryan often represented ordinary American people. Recently, he had also introduced legislation in 15 states to ban the teaching of evolution. Scopes played a rather small role in the case, as the trial became more of a contest between Darrow and Bryan. The trial began in a crowded courtroom of nearly 1,000 people on the first day. However, as the crowds increased, it was soon moved to the lawn outside the courthouse, where as many as 5,000 people watched the proceedings.
Wow! What a show!
Oh, it was. Journalists, preachers, and entrepreneurs from around the country descended on the little mountain town of Dayton, Tennessee to capture the moment, voice their opinions, and make some money.
Wait, how did they make money?
They sold hot dogs, lemonade, and souvenirs from Bibles to stuffed monkeys while chimpanzees performed in sideshow.
Sounds fun!
Well, it was exciting, and it was exactly what Dayton's local leaders wanted.
Really?
Yes, local town leaders staged the trial in Dayton for publicity, since their population had been declining for years.
And it worked!
It sure did. In fact, this trial was the first ever to be broadcast on the radio. A jury of middle-aged farmers and churchgoers was selected. Then Judge Ralston, a conservative Christian, allowed a prayer to begin the proceedings despite the defense's objection.
But I don't understand what the big deal was. Why was everyone so worried about the outcome?
It was a battle between religion and science, between traditional Bible-based explanations and modern scientific theories. Listen to some of the lines from the opening statements.
Scopes isn't on trial. Civilization is on trial.
If evolution wins, Christianity goes.
Opening the doors to a reign of bigotry equal to anything in the Middle Ages.
Dr. Maynard Metcalf, a renowned zoologist at Johns Hopkins University, testified regarding the validity of evolutionary theory. However, the next day, Judge Ralston ruled the testimony inadmissible.
It is not within the province of the court to determine which is true, the story of divine creation as taught in the Bible, or the story of the creation of man as taught by evolution.
Darrow's scientific experts were barred from testifying, and Darrow had lost his best defense.
Tough break. What did the defense do?
Darrow decided that if he was unable to establish Darwin's theory of evolution, then his best defense was to take a more offensive approach and attack the literal translation of the Bible.
And how did that go?
It was very interesting. Very interesting. The defense called William Jennings Bryan, the lead prosecutor, to the stand. Mr. Bryan, they claimed, was an expert on the Bible. The prosecution team was concerned, but Bryan agreed to take the stand anyway. What followed was described in the New York Times as the most amazing court scene in Anglo-Saxon history.
You've given considerable study to the Bible, haven't you, Mr. Bryan?
Yes, I have. I've studied the Bible for about 50 years.
Darrow then asked Bryan about his belief in stories from the Bible, ranging from Jonah and the whale to the creation of Eve from Adam's rib in the Garden of Eden. Bryan initially answered,
"Everything in the Bible should be accepted as it is given there."
But he later conceded that the words of the Bible should not always be taken literally. Then, regarding the flood mentioned in the book of Genesis, Darrow asked Bryan to explain how the year of the flood was calculated.
Do you know how the estimate was arrived at?
I never made a calculation.
Calculation? From what?
I could not say.
What do you think?
I could not say.
From the generations of man?
I would not want to say that.
Do you think?
I do not think about things I do not think about.
Do you think about things you do think about?
Well, sometimes.
The media declared Darrow had won the confrontation with Bryan. However, the next day, Judge Ralston ruled that Bryan's testimony should be stricken from the record anyway. In an unusual move, Darrow then asked the jury to find his client guilty. His goal was to appeal the verdict to the Tennessee Supreme Court on constitutional grounds. The jury complied with this request, and therefore, Bryan was unable to deliver the closing argument speech he had been preparing for weeks.
What happened to John Scopes?
Who?
John Scopes.
Oh, yes, I almost forgot about him. Well, as you can see, this trial wasn't really about him, but the judge did fine him $100 for violating the law.
Really?
Yes, but 1 year later, the Tennessee Supreme Court reversed the decision on a technicality. And then they dismissed the case, saying,
"Nothing is to be gained by prolonging the life of this bizarre case."
Nationally, this was not the end of the debate. However, of the 15 states who were considering anti-evolution legislation in 1925, only Arkansas and Mississippi ended up actually enacting laws restricting the teaching of Darwin's theory. This was a significant setback for those who favored creationism, such as prosecutor William Jennings Bryan, who sadly passed away just 6 days after the trial.
Probably from exhaustion.
He reportedly took a nap after eating a big dinner and never woke up. Some speculate he died of a broken heart after being humiliated on the stand.
That's sad.
What's even sadder is that the creation versus evolution debate has continued into the 21st century. As recently as 2002, some parents in Georgia's Cobb County School District demanded that biology textbooks contain a label warning students that evolution is a theory, not a fact, and should be considered with a critical mind.
Wow, things sure do get complicated when religion gets involved.
Oh, I agree. Maybe we should change the subject. Quick, what case would you like to learn about next?